It is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Buchfuhrer, or Dr. B, as everybody knows him on the discussion board and around the world by at this point. He is our very first official guest on voice chat in the Restless Leg Foundation, and we're very excited to have him. We welcome him, and like Craig said, I have to echo, we welcome everything that he's done for us. I have had the pleasure of meeting Dr. B several times, and I have to tell you that he is certainly on one of the champions of our quality of life, not only with his patients, but everybody out there. He unselfishly provides his time and himself to answer questions by email. He sponsors a group, is the medical director for the Southern California group, which is an absolutely awesome, awesome group, and their website is, bar none, one of the best. And he has recently written in the last 2 years, has had a book published with Dr. Wayne Henning, and the about living with restless legs. Forgive me, I'm sorry, I'm stuttering. The name of that book is Restless Leg Syndrome, Coping with Your Sleepless Nights. And I'd like to add that on the bottom of the screen, Craig has just put on the Amazon.com link so that if you don't have this book already, you can go and buy it. If you have this book already, go and buy it again and give it to somebody to educate them. Leave it in your doctor's office in the front room. Where are we right now? And we can start taking questions after you get finished with where are we right now? And, you know, what's on our plate right now?
Okay. Thanks. I actually got involved with Restless Legs in 1991. It's just about the time the foundation was getting going. And what happened, a patient came to see me. Her real name is Elizabeth Tunison, but she's always been called Bill. I guess her dad wanted a boy instead of a girl. And she was a retired kind of high school principal, professor, came to see me with bad restless legs. She had augmentation from Cinemet, and she'd actually done the research already and wanted me to give her Permax instead. And that's a drug I'd never heard of at the time. So I did a little research and found out a bit about it. Even though I was a sleep specialist, I hadn't seen a heck of a lot of restless legs, as was pretty common with sleep specialists who do mostly sleep apnea. Anyway, we got her fixed up thanks to the help of Permax, and she was so grateful she started a support group. And as I always like to say, she dragged me in kicking and screaming into the support group. I wasn't very willing to start because I had, at the time, three little kids. I was very busy, and this was four Sundays a year, which I wasn't sure I had the time for. But it kind of worked out, and I got real involved when I realized, hey, there are a ton of you patients out there, and there's a lot we can do for you, and there was a lot of needless suffering. So I think I got on the RLS Foundation Medical Advisory Board in 96, and I was on for, it was 96 is when we started our website and our support, our kind of online support group for a local group in Southern California. 99 was when I got involved in the Medical Advisory Board of the RLS Foundation. That was till 2005. I've had a couple of years off, and now I'm back on the Medical Advisory Board. We usually do 2-3 year terms, so I'll probably be on for the next 6 years. Now, it gives you a little introduction to where, kind of how I got involved in restless legs, and I guess with getting the website going, I did quite a bit of work, and then I got recruited. Do the algorithm, which we published in 2004, the Restless Legs algorithm in the Mayo Clinic Proceedings. Not long after that, I wrote the first book you heard before, Coping with Restless Legs, with Wayne Henning, and we actually have two other books I've written with Wayne Henning, both for doctors. The third one is by PCI Communications, and is actually a fairly good book for doctors, and that's probably even a better one to suggest if doctors want some information, and I think you can probably find that on Amazon also. Now, that's, I guess, all the introduction you guys need, as far as I go. As far as where we are with restless legs, clearly we're in a pretty good situation over the last few years where we have two drugs FDA approved and a few drugs on the way. Unfortunately, we were going to have a drug available right now, Requip CR. And most of you may know that Requip was the first drug approved in 2005 for restless legs. It's gone generic as of a few weeks ago, or a month ago or so. Requip CR was supposed to come out to replace it. However, there was a little glitch in the FDA said to the Glaxo people, GSK people, that they have to do a little more research, and they decided that it just wasn't worth it, in part because they have another drug coming down the pike, which will be available right around the time that this drug would have been available, the Requip CR, if they would have done the additional studies required. And I can tell you a little bit more about them, but I think at this point it may be more interesting for you guys to ask me questions so that you can kind of get your own questions answered.
My question is on augmentation. Would you define that, please?
Okay. Augmentation is actually very easy to define, although it's taken doctors years to figure this out. Richard Allen at Johns Hopkins actually was the first one to describe it with a nice paper in 1996. And until then, it really wasn't very well understood. What augmentation is actually a worsening of the restless legs due to taking a medication, typically a dopamine agonist, a dopamine medication like Sinemet or Mirapex or Requip. What happens is weeks or typically months, sometimes it can be even a week or two, especially with Sinemet, but typically it takes 3 or 4 weeks with Sinemet and maybe 2 to 3 or 4 months or a little longer with the dopamine agonists Mirapex and Requip. And what happens is the worsening has a few characteristic qualities. The first is that the restless legs starts to get worse and occurs earlier in the day. So let's say you only have restless legs at bedtime, 11 o'clock when you go to bed. You're put on Requip or Mirapex. 3-4 months later, you start noticing that you're getting symptoms at 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening, which you never had before. And if you keep taking the medication, it perhaps could get even worse so that it starts happening 4 or 5 in the afternoon or even earlier. Now, if that's the only manifestation of the restless legs, that it occurs earlier, usually it's not that big a deal, because then what we'll do is we'll give the medication a little earlier. So instead of giving it at, let's say, 9 or 10 o'clock for the 11 o'clock bedtime, we might give it at 6 p.m., and then it might wipe out the restless legs for the entire evening and take care of that mild augmentation. However, if the augmentation gets worse, such that it keeps occurring earlier in the day and you have to start giving 2 or 3 doses, we better rethink what we're doing. The other thing that happens with augmentation is that the symptoms start becoming more intense. You can't sit as long. They occur sooner, and they're just more intense symptoms. The other characteristic thing is that they will start spreading to other body parts. So, for example, if you only had restless legs in your legs, and after several months after taking the medication, you say, gosh, they're occurring earlier in the day, they're a little more intense, and they're also in my arms, that may be augmentation also. What we feel is going on in augmentation is that the receptors, the dopamine receptors, are getting a little, what's the right word, not happy. You know, they're kind of getting sensitized by the medication, and they're reacting a little strangely. And what's interesting about augmentation, again, it's a worsening of the restless legs to where it was before you started the medication, usually several months before. And the way we can prove that it's augmentation rather than just something else causing it to be worse. Like, for example, sometimes you get a patient who is on a dopamine agonist and they start to get worse and you say, oh my gosh, you know, is it augmentation? Then you find out they've been given an antidepressant like in the Prozac family, and that may be worsening the restless legs. So it's not it may not be the medication. So you have to rule out everything else. But once you've done that, the way to prove it is if you stop the offending drug, which is usually a dopamine agonist or a Sinemet, within a week or two or three, usually 2 weeks, the RLS will go back to where it was at baseline. Of course, you have to be very careful because for about a week or so, the RLS may go into hyperdrive, and you have to treat that week or two of market worsening until things go back to the way they were before.
Dr. B, do you believe that the dopamine medication should be titrated down or stepped off of, or is it okay, depending on time limits, is it okay to just cut them cold?
Okay, well, I'll tell you what I do. When I get a patient with significant augmentation, what I do is I cut them off cold turkey, because the problem is the receptor being bugged by the dopamine. So you want to end it as soon as possible. Now, I know when I do this that the RLS is going to get dramatically worse for about a week or two, as I've just mentioned. So what I do is I supply my patient with usually a potent opioid pain medication in the codeine, Vicodin, oxycodone, methadone family. And I make sure they get enough of it so that they can treat the withdrawal symptoms from getting acutely off of the dopamine agonist or Sinemet or whatever it happens to be. Once that week or two is over, they just simply stop the medication, and then they stop, you know, the opioids, and then we go to plan B and give them something else that will take care of their restless legs.
What is the latest research on the link between iron deficiencies or low ferritin levels in the restless legs?
Okay. The question is, for those of you who may not have heard it completely, is what's the latest research on the link between low iron or low serum ferritin levels and restless legs? Well, most of the research actually, unfortunately, is pretty old. And it's interesting because even way back in 1944, Carl Ekbom, who discovered or in the modern day described the restless leg syndrome, even then he thought that anemia was associated with it, and he saw that it was a high percentage of anemic patients. So we've kind of known a little bit about this link. And in the last 10 years, there have been several papers that have just linked low ferritin levels with restless legs, but these are just studies where they just look at patients and they see how bad they are and what they have, and they found that when the ferritin levels were lower, patients did worse. There's been very few, if any, studies showing that giving iron really improves the situation. We know that a little bit anecdotally, but they haven't done too much of that. So most of the data that we have is just looking at statistics on patients who have restless legs and find out that they have lower ferritins than with patients without restless legs, and the ones that tend to be worse are the ones with the lower ferritins. Now, the exception to what I've just said is the group at Johns Hopkins, which is led by Richard Allen and Chris Early. They've been doing a lot of research in iron. In fact, that's the foremost clinical place that iron research in restless legs is being done. There's another place with John Connor, and I'm just blanking which university he's associated with, but he's the other one. He's a PhD, not an MD, and they're doing more kind of theoretical research rather than the clinical, the more clinical stuff that Early and Allen are doing at Johns Hopkins. But I'll tell you some interesting data on this that is fascinating for me, and that is fascinating for me, and I'm sure it'll be fascinating for you guys. What the Johns Hopkins guys did a few years ago is they took a bunch of fairly severe restless leg patients. They examined their serum ferritin levels. And just let me say, for those of you who don't quite understand ferritin and iron and anemia and all these things, iron's important, is necessary to make the hemoglobin, which is the red stuff in the red cells, the red blood cells. So when you don't have enough iron, you can't make enough red cells. You can measure a person's, how anemic someone is by looking at the red cells or what we call the hemoglobin. But that's the last thing that happens when you're low on iron, because the body will fight, even when you're pretty darn low on iron, the body will fight to produce red cells. So what we next did is we looked at the iron levels, and that's the next best thing to do to see if there's an iron problem after looking at the hemoglobin. You could have a normal hemoglobin and the iron levels may be a little low, but the body's still doing well. However, that still doesn't give us a good clue, because sometimes you can have a normal hemoglobin, normal iron levels in the blood, but there still may be a body deficiency of iron storage. So what we then do is we look at serum ferritin, and that's how the body typically stores iron. So even in a patient with a normal hemoglobin and normal iron, we sometimes find low serum ferritin. Of course, the absolute best way to find out how well the iron stores are in the body is to do a bone marrow biopsy, which is unfortunately very painful and is done on patients who you're really concerned about what their iron stores are, or chemotherapy patients get this all the time to check their blood cells and iron, etc. But we don't like to do that, so the serum ferritin is the most accurate way that we doctors, and especially we restless leg doctors, like to look at the iron status of patients. So what the team at Hopkins did is they looked at serum ferritin levels, but they even went one step further. They took what we call CSF, cerebrospinal fluid, levels of ferritin. And what that requires is to do a spinal tap, put a needle right between two of the spines, usually in the lower back, and suck out a little bit of cerebrospinal fluid that runs in the spine and around the brain. It all communicates together. So by checking the levels of ferritin there, you can see what the brain levels of ferritin are. And of course, that's the most accurate for restless legs. So what they found is that most of these patients, or most all of them, had low ferritin in the CSF around the brain and spine. Some of them even had pretty good levels in the blood, but the brain was low. And that's what happens, because the body will pull all the iron in the form of ferritin away from the brain and other places. It will suffer so that we can get enough iron into the bone marrow. Now, so what they found these low levels, and what they did is they didn't give oral iron. Now, oral iron is pretty tough to take. People get nausea and stomach upset. People get constipation. Some get diarrhea. The ideal way to take it is an hour before eating on an empty stomach, of course, with some vitamin C to acidify the stomach and make it absorb better, which makes it absorb very well, but increases the chance of getting some stomach upset. And even after all that, it's really tough to get the levels up. So what these guys did at Hopkins, they bypassed that. They gave the iron intravenously. And by doing that, they brought the level way up. Now, typically what we say when we check a serum iron level, or ferritin level, sorry, is we want it to get the level above 50. Most of the labs report normal levels as over 10 or 20. We're a little more aggressive. We want it over 50. But what the guys at Hopkins did, they gave it intravenously, usually about two or three or four series of infusions of this iron, and they got the levels around 200. Well, lo and behold, about 80%+ of the patients all of a sudden had their RLS symptoms completely vanish. They could drop all their medication, and these were severe patients for the most part. They dropped all their medications. they felt great. They said, my RLS is cured. Anyway, very interestingly, 6 months to maybe 2 years later, these patients started calling back and saying, my RLS is coming back. What's going on? So they brought them back to Hopkins and rechecked their serum ferritins and their CSF ferritins, the ferritins around their brain. And lo and behold, these guys were again low on ferritin. Now, typically, when we get someone with iron deficiency, anemia or not, and we tank them up full of iron, and this typically this will be someone who has like a bleeding ulcer or a woman with heavy menstrual periods or God knows what, who get low on iron, once we tank them up, unless they bleed again, they're good for life. So this was very perplexing. Excuse me. And now what we believe is that the real defect in restless leg syndrome may in fact be a leaching out of iron faster than normal. So we all lose a little iron every day, but we get it back in our diet very, very easily. And we feel that restless leg patients are losing it much faster, so the normal diet doesn't come close to replacing it. And the guys at Hopkins postulate that the genetic defect may be something to do with iron metabolism, and that the RLS is only secondary to that.
Can one get augmentation while on gabapentin?
The answer is absolutely not, unless you're on a dopamine agonist with it. But gabapentin has never, ever been reported to cause augmentation. The only drugs that cause augmentation are so far the dopamine drugs, which are Sinemet, Mirapex and Requip. The only exception to that rule is that Ultram, which is generically called Tramadol. There's been a couple of cases reported by Richard Allen in one of the sleep journals. And in fact, I've seen a few patients myself with augmentation induced from Tramadol or Ultram. But except for the drugs I've mentioned, no other drugs have ever, ever been associated with augmentation.
Shut up, Pop. Go ahead. Yeah. We can hear you.
Yes, my ferritin level is 3, and but no doctors seem to want to do the IV.
Well, here's the story. First of all, are you anemic also?
Not that I, nope. All my other counts are okay.
Okay, and here's the dilemma we have. In this case, the serum ferritin is low, but she's managing to squeeze enough hemoglobin out of that, you know, whatever iron store she has in the ferritin, so she's not that anemic. And here's what the rule is, because I've given a couple of iron infusions, but only to patients that are anemic and you can't improve the anemia. The problem we have is that although there's some very rare reactions to iron infusion, we call them anaphylactic reactions, kind of a super allergic reaction, which someone can even die from, although they occur very rarely, they're so serious that we don't want to give iron infusions unless there's another reason like anemia that won't respond to oral iron, or if we're doing it experimentally. Now, I can tell you, a lot of the kidney doctors who have a lot of anemic patients give this all the time, and really it's much, much safer now than the old days. This anaphylactic reaction used to occur with the older preparations, but the legacy of this fear is still here, and most doctors, I hate to say it, myself included, are a little reticent to give iron infusion therapy intravenously unless we have refractory anemia or anemia that won't improve with conservative measures.
Can you hear me?
Sure can.
Okay. The people who benefit from the IV solution, how were they considered anemic? What was the test that showed they were anemic? And for how many years have they been anemic?
Okay, the patients who got the iron fusion therapy at John Hopkins, almost none of them were anemic. They just had low serum ferritin levels, meaning under 50. But the majority of them were actually not anemic and would not have been given intravenous iron by any other doctor. The Hopkins guys were doing this on an investigation, a research basis, with a protocol that was approved and, you know, patients gave consent. So they're doing it with informed consent in a very different way. So really the only criteria that for them to be admitted was to have a serum ferritin of under 50.
I do have a question. I have severe restless leg. I've had it for about 3 years now. It's 24 hours a day. It never goes away. I've been put on Requip and gabapentin was my first doses. I was up to 3 milligrams of Requip, and I can't remember the amount of gabapentin, but when I reached 3 milligrams of Requip, I started experiencing severe stabbing pains in my calves. And I talked to my doctor, and word that came out of his mouth was fibromyalgia. And my question to you, doctor, is do you know of any relationship between fibromyalgia and the increase of the Requip?
Not really. In fact, I'll tell you a couple of interesting stories about this. There's a big overlap between fibromyalgia and restless legs. We don't really understand fibromyalgia that well, or how to diagnose fibromyalgia. I don't want to go into great detail, but you need a bunch of trigger points, you have to be fatigued, and there's a lot of very common symptoms that occur with many disorders. So until very recently, many physicians did not even believe that fibromyalgia was a distinct disorder. But what you tend to see is patients with restless legs who don't sleep well may have a lot of fibromyalgia symptoms. So we tend to see quite a few. In fact, at our Southern California support group meetings in which we have, we often get 30, 40, 50, 100 people, we've had a few times where we have groups of 20, 30 fibromyalgia patients come. So there is this connection already. However, although we have two drugs recently approved for fibromyalgia, and one of them is Lyrica, which we use for restless legs, so it also helps both problems, and recently they have approved Cymbalta, which is an antidepressant drug similar to Effexor, not too much different than the Prozac family of drugs. And that's supposed to help fibromyalgia. However, that's a drug that worsens restless legs, so there's a little difference here. However, there's a book written by a doctor in Oregon, in the Portland area, called The Fibromyalgia Cure. He wrote it about 4 or 5 years ago, and two of his miracle drugs to cure the fibromyalgia were Mirapex and Requip. So if anything, at least I'm not an expert in the fibromyalgia, but some of the previous experts actually propounded using the dopamine agonist to treat fibromyalgia. So I would have to venture to say that it would be very unlikely for the dopamine agonist to cause fibromyalgia. Furthermore, I have used a zillion doses of Requip and Mirapex. And although I sometimes I get paradoxical responses where the restless legs gets worse or some other funny things, there certainly has been no significant episodes of fibromyalgia coming out of the blue. Furthermore, your description of what your symptoms are don't exactly meet the criteria of fibromyalgia. So even though your doctor said, oh, fibromyalgia, I'm not sure that qualifies for a definitive diagnosis. And I can tell you, even in the best of hands, which is usually a rheumatologist, those are the fibro experts these days, or sometimes a neurologist, but even in the best of hands, it is often difficult to establish the diagnosis of fibromyalgia.
Dr. B, I did get everybody's blinking lights. Don't worry about it. I see everybody. But Dr. B, I'd like to ask you, I've always used the, since I'm one of the people who has pain with RLS, when we talk about pain with RLS or pain with due to fibromyalgia, what I found was that my RLS is very predictable in the same place every time, and whereas my fibromyalgia friends with RLS, their pain moves around.
Yeah, that's correct. The thing that kind of is the hallmark of fibromyalgia is that they have generalized achy muscles. And in fact, I'm not an expert enough to tell you how many trigger points you need. And what trigger points are is what the doctor does is he puts his thumb fairly hard into different muscle points, and and if they hurt, that's called a trigger point. And you have to have so many trigger points to be diagnosed as a fibro patient. So this is, you know, more generalized, where it'll be a point in the back, in the arms, in the leg, could be all over. Whereas restless legs, all you restless leg guys know that you're getting it in one leg, both legs, sometimes alternating, sometimes arms, but as you heard before, it is very predictable where the problem occurs.
Jen has Jen's restless legs. I seem to have developed RLS after getting off of trazodone. Is that possible? Also, does Lexapro cause RLS?
Okay, coming off trazodone shouldn't really cause restless legs. Trazodone is actually a restless leg friendly antidepressant. But it's typically a poor antidepressant. It has a sleepy quality. In fact, a lot of general physicians use it as a sleeping pill because it's not addicting, although it tends to make people groggy if you get the right dose to help people sleep. They get groggy the next day. But just stopping it shouldn't make restless leg worse, to the best of my knowledge. I've actually never seen that happen before, but anything is possible. Perhaps if it was treating some of the anxiety or depression and stopping it increased that problem, RLS often gets worse when other problems get worse. The second question, part of the question, was Lexapro. Lexapro is one of the SSRI drugs. These are the antidepressants in the Prozac family. In fact, the group, I'll list off the ones in that group. They are, Prozac was the initial one, then Paxil, Celexa. Lexapro is actually just a pure form of Celexa. Zoloft is in there also. Those are the main SSRIs. All of those tend to worsen restless legs. Now, there are patients who can take those and have little or no problem, but I would say the majority of patients will get some significant worsening of restless legs if they go on one of those SSRIs.
When I take the medication for pain, such as ibuprofen, Tylenol, even Percocet, all interact with my Mirapex and cause a worsening of RLS. Any suggestions? That's from Harriet.
Okay. That's kind of a little strange, because typically the anti-inflammatories like Motrin, ibuprofen, etc., and aspirin and Tylenol really have no positive or negative effect on restless legs. Now, one thing I'll say, whenever I say anything general about restless legs, patients are weird in general, and RLS patients are weirder than most. So anything I
Thank
say in
you.
General, you're welcome. Anything I say in general will always have exceptions. So I can't explain that whatsoever. But the more unusual part of that is Percocet, which is a very strong combination of regular Tylenol and oxycodone. should actually eliminate restless legs. We use that all the time with Percocet or just with pure oxycodone, and it is one of the more powerful opioids that should actually dramatically improve restless legs. So you have me there. I've rarely, if ever, heard a patient complain that an opioid actually made restless legs worse, because 98% of them will get improvement with an opioid.
Herod, if you want to email a follow-up question, please do. The next question is, I'm trying to get off of Mirapex because I think it makes me have impulse or obsession behavior. Obsessive behavior. I have also tried WeQuip with the same results. Any suggestions what to try?
Yeah. Well, there's unfortunately a very small percentage of patients who get this compulsive behavior, or better termed, impulse control problems. And of course, they can manifest as gambling problems, shopping problems, or other things that are kind of impulse control issues. This usually occurs at the higher doses that the Parkinson patients use the same dopamine agonist, Mirapex and Requip for, but we now are seeing a whole bunch of restless leg patients even at the lower doses. If this occurs, by the way, sometimes this is what we call a dose response type of thing, where a lower dose may not cause it, but a little higher dose may. But typically what I do with that, because you don't want to see people have these impulse control problems. We've had people who lose lots of money when they're on this medication because they're buying things they don't need, or they gamble, or God knows what. So because it can be a fairly serious problem, we usually stop the medication. The alternatives that we suggest are the anticonvulsants like gabapentin, the trade name is Neurontin, or pregabalin, which is the trade name for that is Lyrica. The other choice would be to go on a low dose of a pain medication such as an opioid or tramadol, which often works very well, and sometimes I'll combine them. But those are the typical alternatives for people who are having unwanted effects with the dopamine agonist.
Is there something other than meds to take during the day? I now take Ropinirole 3 milligrams per night, which I just started instead of Requip. These seem to act like muscle relaxers and make me sleepy. Is there anything for while you want to be active? And the second question, so I'm guessing is this person's at 3 milligrams. Is there something else that this person can do during the day because it makes them sleepy? But this person also had a second question, that is there any other meds that can help? I know caffeine, et cetera. But any other thoughts on what can help other than, you know, what we can cut out, I guess?
Okay. Well, that's kind of a difficult problem, and there's two ways to look at it. If the Mirapex and Requip can easily cause sleepiness, especially if taken at reasonable doses during the daytime, which this particular patient is doing, strangely enough, we even see the paradoxical effect. We have some patients who get insomnia with these medications, so they can do funny things in the brain, and they can be totally opposite in different patients. So very tricky to understand. However, you really have two choices here. If the medication is doing a good job on the restless legs, and you say, God, I don't want to stop this because I don't want to go to the other classes, then you're stuck either being sleepy or what I would do, and I actually have done this a few times, is give a drug like Provigil. Provigil, the generic on that is modafinil, and it's a drug that sleep specialists like myself use quite a lot for patients who have narcolepsy, sleep apnea, and other extra sleepy disorders, for things that make people extra sleepy during the daytime. Now, just let me add, I particularly do not like adding a medication to treat the side effect of another medication. Sometimes we're stuck and we have to do that. But if I have my choice, what I would do with a patient who complains of sleepiness with Mirapex and or Requip is change to another class of medication. Unfortunately, gabapentin, which is one of the anticonvulsants, and one of the alternatives, tends to make people sleepy also. Lyrica is a little less so, but still can make people sleepy. Often when I have trouble, I go to the opioids or tramadol, and it's surprising how well a whole bunch of the patients who have trouble with the other medications still tolerate these and don't have any sleepiness. So we either change to one of the alternatives I mentioned, or if we don't like doing that, we may consider adding the drug Provigil to the existing regimen. But again, I'm not a big fan of treating a side effect of a drug with another by adding another medication.
I was just wondering about wrapping my legs really tightly with an ACE bandage when nothing else seems to help, whether or not that could be harmful. I fall asleep with it, and it's like as tight as I can get it, practically.
Well, the answer to that is people get really concerned with ACE bandages being wrapped tightly and extremities, the feet turning purple, and they figure, oh my God, you know, maybe the foot's going to fall off, you're going to get gangrene overnight. No concern whatsoever. What you're cutting off when you do stuff like that typically is the venous circulation. And you might get some swelling or some temporary problems, but the arterial circulation goes at a much, much higher pressure. And it would be very, very tough to really put it tight enough to cut off that circulation. I mean, you know, when someone has a limb, or a wound or a limb amputated or something like that, we can put a tourniquet on tight enough to do that. But that, trust me, if you get it to that level, you probably would not be able to fall asleep. So not much of a concern. And if that works for you, that's fine.
Okay, I have a question, an email question from Kate, Missouri. I have severe RLS and PLMD, successfully treated with Mirapex. Recently have had severe full leg cramping at night, sometimes one leg, sometimes both legs. Is this cramping typical of RLS or PMLD?
No, the leg cramping is a totally separate problem. It has absolutely positively nothing to do with RLS or PLMD. Unfortunately, we have no idea what causes leg cramps. We know some situations such as, fatigue of the legs and things like that, that may bring it on at times, but not always predictably. However, these are absolutely positively separate problems. They just happen to occur in the legs, so people kind of associate them together. And in the old days, when you can get quinine sulfate fairly inexpensively and over the counter or even by prescription inexpensively, doctors used to prescribe or recommend that left, right, and center for every restless leg patient. Of course, what's happened over the last few years is we now can barely get quinine, which is the only treatment we know that actually helps prevent the leg cramping, but it has to be taken before. But again, these are totally separate problems.
And the FDA just recent, beginning of this year, put out a warning about taking quinine without being under a doctor's consent.
Well, actually, here's what happened. Because you cannot get quinine without a prescription for the last several years. But what has changed more recently is the FDA put out a warning. First of all, what they did is they got rid of all the generic quinine. They only let one company produce it, and now it's only brand name and very expensive, and it's only indicated for malaria. So what happened is most doctors, when they see the FDA put out something strong like that, will not prescribe it. Now, I still prescribe it, although most of my patients can't seem to afford it anymore because of the high cost, but like any other drug that's not FDA approved for that condition, we can prescribe it if we think it's medically warranted. We've always been able to do that. and until 2005, every single drug that I prescribed for restless legs was not FDA approved, but I still did it. Again, this is just a new warning, so the average doctor usually gets pretty scared by stuff like that and will not do that, but doctors like myself who are very familiar with quinine, in fact, I wrote an article about it in one of the Nightwalker several years ago because it kind of overlaps. So I prescribe a lot and familiar with it, so it doesn't really bother me to prescribe it.
That's good to know. The next question is from Trev by email, and it says, what is the prevalence of debilitating 24/7 RLS?
Well, I can answer you that we do not know the answer to that question definitively. But here's what we can tell from the stats that we have in general. Typically, if you look at the population studies, and the best study was the REST, R-E-S-T study, done by Wayne Henning, and actually there's the REST study was done in primary care practices, and then Richard Allen did a companion one in the general population. So there's two REST studies where it occurs 24/7. They then found that roughly a third of the patients had what we call a third of the 10%, so roughly 3%, had restless legs enough to be called RLS sufferers. And the way they defined that was the restless legs had to occur twice a week or more, and they had to have negative impacts on their quality of life questionnaires. Significant. So they were, these were the people we called sufferers.
Okay, I have one more email question. It's a follow-up.
Okay.
I've been on Lexapro for years and developed RLS a few months ago. I should try to get off of Lexapro. Should I try to get off of Lexapro, or what would you recommend?
Okay. We get the situation quite often. And my recommendation for anyone with depression and restless legs goes as follows. If the depression occurred before the restless legs ever occurred, and it's quite significant depression, and the medication you're getting is helping it, I would not consider stopping the medication. I would just treat around the medication, despite the fact that the medication may be worsening the restless legs. Now, if you haven't tried Wellbutrin, which is the generic on that is bupropion, but easier to say Wellbutrin, it may be worth a trial of going on Wellbutrin, which is an RLS-friendly antidepressant. It's actually a pretty good one, but antidepressants are very peculiar from person to person, and what works for one doesn't work for the other, even ones that are chemically very close. So Wellbutrin won't work for everyone. It's worth a try. Now, on the other hand, if someone comes to me and the RLS was pretty bad, was there for a while and pretty bad, and then the depression occurs and the patient was treated, I know there's a reasonable chance that the medication given to the patient may have been given for untreated RLS symptoms that cause depression and anxiety. Then I try to get the patient off and see what happens. So in the case here, if the Lexapro really does a good job and, you know, you've tried other stuff, it doesn't work well, and that really takes care of the problem, I would probably stick on it because it sounds like you were on it well before the restless leg problem.
Maternal grandmother and parental grandfather both had Parkinson's. Could you explain how RLS and Parkinson's are related, or are they not?
Okay, that's a very common question because obviously the two only approved drugs and best drugs for restless legs tend to be are the two Parkinson drugs. So. That question comes up often. In fact, in the book, I wrote the section that, in my book, Coping with Restless Legs, Coping with Your Sleepless Nights, I wrote a section on the medication, and in a big box I put, RLS does not lead to Parkinson's disease. So the fact that you have restless legs does not make Parkinson's more likely to ever occur, although, you know, people can have both. Now, in the group of Parkinson patients, we do see more restless leg symptoms. So that part is true. However, they get these dopamine agonists right away and dopamine-type drugs. So often the RLS symptoms get treated pretty quickly. So someone with a family history of Parkinson's, I would not worry about restless legs occurring any more readily. But once you have restless legs yourself, of course, it's genetic. So your family is 6 times more likely to have restless legs, any member of your family.
Craig, did you have a question?
Yes. Okay, it's kind of a follow-up question to what was talked about before with the augmentation. There, on the RLS forums, there's some discussion about permanent augmentation, e.g., if you don't stop the Mirapex in time and you're being augmented, then over a period of time, somehow that is going to become permanent. I think you know where I'm going with that. So I don't think there's any proof of that, but if you have any educated opinion.
Oh, yeah. I can tell you that that's probably not the case. One of the things that with augmentation is a receptor phenomena. The receptor gets fatigued or irritated or who knows what. Once you stop the Mirapex or Requip, things will go back to baseline sooner or later. The problem many people have is they find they can't get to that point because they try to stop the medication and they're not being given something else, so they go into RLS hyperdrive and they feel it's, they really can't get down or off the medication to really feel better. Now, there may be some cases of people who are on Mirapex or Requip get worse and then even stop the medication and aren't better, but I would bet that those are not true augmentation cases, and those may be cases where the RLS just got worse either due to time naturally or maybe some other circumstances, increased stress, an offending medication, more iron deficiency, God knows what.
That was myself who asked the Parkinson's question because that's just my concern because no one in my family has admitted to RLS except myself. Who has been your youngest patient or how young have you been coming across patients and how long have they had RLS?
Yeah. Okay, I can answer that question very easily. First of all, let me just say that of the group that has a family history of RLS, roughly a third will have the onset before age 21. Now,
I've had mine all my life.
Yeah, and that's what you hear a lot of that. In fact, I'll give you a couple of statistics in a minute, but just to answer the question, what was my youngest patient? My youngest patient was 4 years old. And in fact, this is a patient I had to treat. And his mother, who's also my patient, has restless legs. His grandmother is not my patient, but had restless legs, also fairly severe. They noticed that the grandmother, that the grandson was kicking in at about 6 or 7 months. And she looked and she said, I think this kid has restless legs. And they watched and watched. And by the time he was 4 years old, he had fairly bad restless legs. And in fact, they brought him to a pediatric neurologist who runs a sleep lab down in Orange County, which is about 30 miles away from where I am, 30, 40 miles away. And the pediatric neurologist said this, nope, restless legs doesn't occur in kids, and wanted to do some other tests and didn't have a clue. So they eventually got to me and we took care of this kid. And it was interesting is even though he's 4 years old, he gave me a better history of RLS, the four criteria, than most adults do. Now, there's been some recent studies. This is actually the REST study. I just told you the REST study in the adults. There's been the rest study by Dan Piketty. He's a pediatric neurologist who is very interested in restless legs. And he did the pediatric restless leg study. And what they found, actually, is in children age 8 to 18, they just chose that age group to study. They could have done it earlier, but they didn't. 2% of kids age 8 to 18 have restless legs, and about 40% of that 2% have it significantly enough to bother their daily lives.
Dr. B, I asked a question on the discussion board some time ago, and I'd really like to have your input on this. I found that, and I'm very lucky, I get to see Dr. Becker, and I have somebody who's really well qualified in this area and just awesome. But my problem is now, after, you know, on the list of medications that I take, and I'm not the only one either in this room or in our community, that Our medications look so wild to anybody who is not educated in RLS that I have a hard time going to other doctors for non-RLS reasons, because I have to explain RLS, the list of medications, and if I ever have a problem that involves pain, then they think I'm looking for drugs.
Oh, and
how do I go about seeing non-RLS doctors?
Okay, that actually is a very, very big problem. I've had patients who have refused to take some of the more potent, you know, opioids especially, or change from one to less potent because of the looks they get from doctors and even the looks they get from the pharmacist who is dispensing it to them.
Absolutely.
One of the things I tell patients to do, and again, this may be slightly self-serving, but I'll explain the whole thing, is take my book along. And you can highlight the area in my book, and I've had actually patients do this. They just take the book along and say, look, you know, some of them have spoken to me, or they say, I'm doing this based on this information, and they just have that area highlighted. And just let me add, for any of you who don't have my book, the profits go to the RLS Foundation, so it's not that self-serving for me to tell you to go out and get more copies of my book. But I've had patients either do that or photocopy the page, and you know, and actually it does help the doctors when they can see, you know, a real book written by MDs, you know, who are experts in this. And that's what it says. And in fact, since I wrote the section, I know what it says there. And even the third book, which is a doctor-oriented book on restless legs, I wrote that the section on treatment and all that stuff. And it's I've written the same things in there that could be easily photocopied and shown to any doctor. And in fact, I think in the doctor book, I even have the references. There's a few references. One is by John Winkleman, who's a psychiatrist at Harvard, who's very into restless legs. And he wrote a paper on methadone, and so did Bill Ondo. So there's a bunch of literature which is actually, you can either find it in the book, or then you can email me sometime, and I can probably give you some of the references if you can't find it in the books, okay?
Okay. I have an email question. I'm a long-term chronic pain person. Chronic pain patient. I have to take
opioids.
For 10 years, and thank you. And Remeron. After 10 years of Remeron, caused my RLS to worsen to a horrible point, but after stopping Remeron, it's back to...
Well, obviously, if you're talking about how to treat the depression, then we're kind of stuck because you know, there's only so many, and most of them worse than restless legs. Again, what I would hard to say what to do, because you have a limited range of medications to take. In fact, the only patients I have trouble with are the patients who really give me a very tiny pool of medications I can use, because they seem to be bugged by everything. And that's when I have my hand tied my hands tied like that, that's when I may have difficulty making patients better. But just let me add for everyone listening, in the right hands with all the available medications we have, we can make 98% of restless leg patients 95% better. So there are exceptions. There's, you know, to any, you heard me say earlier, to every rule that you'll hear me say or generalized statement, there are exceptions, and there's always a few percent that no matter what you do, every medication they look at, they have a reaction to. So it's hard to give specific advice, but you know what I would consider for patients who are having trouble with all the antidepressants, you may try things like the anticonvulsants like Lyrica and gabapentin or Neurontin. Sometimes you can get some added benefit there, but those are cases really that have to be gone over, you know, one by one with a with someone who's a very familiar with restless legs to kind of come up with a plan. And often it's just a lot of trial and error. I often tell my patients what makes me better than most doctors who treat RLS is just I've been there, done that so often, and I have tried everything, and I'm willing to try just about everything. My high success rate often comes just from experience and persistence.
And we appreciate that.
Thank you.
Okay, next email question is, I have no family history of RLS. The doctor said that it could be due to a back injury from a car accident when this person was younger. And also, the second question is, have you heard of alcoholism causing RLS?
Okay. The first part of the question was, would an old back injury cause RLS? To the best of our knowledge, that really shouldn't happen. However, what we do see a lot, and this is undocumented, but I've written about it in some of my books, is that often an accident, especially trauma to the spine, may trigger restless legs or worsen it. Now, some doctors have said, oh yeah, just something you kind of, you know, something serious like that is something you remember and you may coincidentally associate it with it, but I've seen this many times, and we do believe that there may be some link to trauma, especially trauma to the spine, whether it's surgery or a car accident, that may trigger or worsen restless legs. Again, how and why that works, no clue at all. Now, the second part of the question, actually, I forgot. I've talked enough, I've forgotten what the second part of the
question is. Can alcoholism cause RLS?
Okay. Alcohol itself tends to worsen restless legs. So, clearly, if someone has a problem with alcoholism where they can't control the amount they drink, their restless legs may be ratcheted up to quite a degree. Alcohol and caffeine are probably the two biggest offending drugs we get in our diet or otherwise that may worsen restless legs. Rye at Emory and the Iceland group with him that found a gene that was more with PLMs but still correlated with restless legs. And that gene and two more were found by a totally independent group, which is made up of the German group and French-Canadian group. So now that we know there's a gene or there's some genes involved, what makes this very interesting is if we can figure out the proteins that these genes make, we may then, through the back door, try to figure out exactly what the real genetic problems are with restless legs and get a true cure. We're probably looking at a 10-plus year time frame on this, but frankly, these are some of the most exciting bits of data that have come out for RLS in the last 10 or more years.
On the augmentation, I've been on like Cinemat and then Mirapex probably since 94. Is there any long-term studies on, you know, disadvantages of being on a dopamine agonist for that long? And with the augmentation, could I just take a drug holiday, go off of it? I know it would be 2 weeks of, you know, hell probably, and then to go back on,
play
it better.
No, the answer to your question is there are no long-term problems with being on Mirapex or Equip for restless legs, even if you're on for years. I've had people on those drugs since, you know, 91 when I started doing this. Of course, Mirapex and Requip only became available in 96. So for those two drugs, we only have about 12 years. But the only long-term effect we worry about is the augmentation itself. Now, the drug holiday is a reasonable idea, but here's the thing about a drug holiday. First of all, you don't have to be worried about the hyperdrive of restless leg that occurs when you stop the drug if you can get your physician to prescribe some opioids, and that usually takes care of it. However, if you just go back on the same dose of the Mirapex, Requip, or whatever, Sinemet, you're almost guaranteed to get the problem back. Here's what I do. If the person got augmentation with Mirapex, I'll put him back after a drug holiday of a few weeks on Requip. If he was on Requip, I'll put him on Mirapex. But the trick is use a lower dose. If you use a lower dose, you may have a good shot at not getting the augmentation back. However, since a lower dose may not work as well, you typically have to add another medication. And what I'll do is I'll add a low dose of maybe gabapentin or an opioid or Ultram or something. And that way I can get by with smaller doses of a couple of drugs, which may be less bothersome.
Dr. B, I often quote you saying something that I heard you say at the very first, maybe not, it might have been in San Antonio or Atlanta, who knows. But I often quote you saying that when you were talking about medications, that it's a very good idea to take the lowest class for the lowest class at the lowest dose in the cleanest form for the longest time. Do you still believe that that's the way to go about this?
Sure.
I mean, long-term care.
Yeah. What I always do with restless legs, with any problem, I'm always trying to look at the lowest dose I can get the person on that does the job. And you know, if you're using an opioid, you start with the weakest you can and work up only when you have to. In fact, I didn't like the Requip titration kit that doctors were given because they kind of went up too quickly and not with the slower increments that I did. Like they would go from 0.25 for 2 days, then right to 0.5, and then from 0.5 to 1. What I would do is I'd give the patient 0.25 for 5 days, and every 5 days you go up by 0.25. So I had a lot of patients who would end up on 0.75. And sometimes with Mirapex, I even go more slowly. I'll have patients sometimes start with half a tablet of Mirapex and go up by half tablets. So I'll have patients on really weird doses like 0.375 of Mirapex, plus one and a half tablets or three of the 0.25 or three tablets of the 0.125. And I get these weird doses which are just a little lower, and I think in the long run, by just being a little more careful, getting slightly lower doses than you can with titration kits, I end up with patients who have less problems.
I would agree, but you're the very first expert I've ever heard that said that about the Requip kit.
You know, I'll tell you something. And actually, I was involved in designing the Requip kit, as were the as was Mirapex, along with some of the other doctors who you probably know. And here's what's very interesting: when we were at the meetings, advising the companies on what to do, we had a third. Here's when they came up with the kit, which they presently have now, especially the Requip one. Here's what happened: a third of the doctors, like me, in my camp, said too fast. A third of the doctors said just right, and a third said way too slow and wanted to go much faster.
Wow.
And it just shows you the difference of opinion among experts. Now, one of the things I can say is that in the group, most of the doctors, except a few of us, were also movement disorder specialists, neurologists who do a lot of Parkinson's, and they use massively higher doses and are very comfortable with it. but at different diseases, I've said. They don't, what works for one doesn't work for the other. And I think that the difference is that people like myself who are not neurologists, so I come from a different camp, a different viewpoint on this, and I have a zillion restless leg patients, you know, probably more than almost anyone as far as, you know, just seeing people on a day-to-day in the trenches as an outpatient. You know, you just learn kind of to be a little more conservative, and you see it works better. When you're not looking as closely, you may miss these little finer things. I've had some patients who end up on like 2 milligrams. I say, why did you go to 2 milligrams? Well, my doc who gave it to me says, just keep increasing the dose. So, you know, they don't always realize that lower is better and that once you're nailed, don't go any higher. So you do tend to see a little more problems in those who, in general, what I've seen is people who go a little higher will have a higher degree or a higher incidence of side effects. So lower is always better. And one of my things with restless legs is, hey, before you guys get to a doctor, it has been years or decades. So, you know, if you've gone that long, does it really make a difference to me whether I get someone well in a few days or in a couple of weeks? Not really. Especially if I tell them before they leave, hey, it's going to take a while, kind of like an antidepressant. It may take 2 or 3 weeks, but just keep, you know, but sooner or later it'll probably help you. But in my book, slower has always been better. If you want to know if you want to learn the brand names and generics, you're all available. You're all free to look at my website, which is www.rlshelp.org. And if you turn to the treatment page, I have all the medications pretty well listed with their generic and trade names, and you can look at, I even have for the opioids, a little chart with their potency.
Just want to make sure everybody knows about, if you didn't read the 200 spam messages below, you know, to check us out every Thursday, not just this Thursday, but every Thursday at 9 Central, 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific for RLS support, online voice chats. It's the wave of the future.